Today we are starting a brand new series. I'm calling it It's Messy. And this morning, if you've been around the church, you know that God was giving us some illustrations because stuff wasn't working right. This wasn't firing off right. This wasn't. And then you know what I just said? Like, God, it's messy. And we just know that that's how life is. The other day I was in the living room. It was early in the morning. Well, I say early in the morning, early-ish. It was about like 7. That's early. Some people, it's not early, other people. And I'm in the living room. We have a little lamp on, a little light, and I'm in there. And I'm reading, and Christy, her spot is out on the back deck, and she's reading, and she's having her time, and she's been up way earlier than me. And I hear the door open, and she's like, "Hey, good morning." It's like, it's good to see the energy. And then I hear her go, "Ah!" And in my mind, I'm thinking, what have I done in such a short span of time to make her so mad at me, right? Because like all of a sudden, it's like, "Good morning, hey, how'd you sleep?" And then I'm like, I'm going through like scenarios in my head. So I get up and turn around, and I see what happened in the situation. One of our smallest members of our family, small hairy members of our family, Coco, had not made it outside. He'd left a cute little present right behind. Actually, this happened twice in the past, like, 3 weeks. So it happens once, shame on you. Twice, then shame on you. I don't know how that. But so, oh, my gosh, it was so bad. Like, between the toes kind of bad. And just, like, oh, great, great little present. The night before, our youngest child, Mackenzie, she said, "I want to make some cookies." She's always wanting to cook, and she enjoys being in the kitchen. And we don't enjoy her being in the kitchen for obvious reasons because, well, you would think safety reasons. No, she's messy. She's messy. And then all of a sudden we hear the word, "Oops." What's oops? "I broke the eggs." "How many?" "All of them. Every egg is on the floor, broken in front of the stove, seeping under the oven." I feel like in just a couple of minutes, you've got a small glimpse into our life. Like that right there is like, I feel like there's moments of order between all the moments of mess. Would anybody say, I completely understand and I agree? We even have words that describe this. Anybody ever say, like, "Oh, bless this mess"? You know what I'm talking about? Or like, I'm a hot mess today. Oh, man. Would anybody in here be bold enough just to admit you're a messy person? Anybody? Yeah. If you don't agree with that, let's all take a field trip out to your car and look in your floorboards. Right? Stuffed up under. We all have a level of mess. I'm the messy person. I'm okay with a level of mess. There's a level that it's cool. Christy has no level of mess. She's a make the bed before we leave the house person, and I'm saying we're gonna mess it up again tonight. Doesn't make any sense to me, but it's gotta be made. It's gotta be tight. But you know what? Everybody has a level of mess. Some of us hide it better. Some of us are okay with different levels, but we all have a level of it. Because you know what I've learned is that life itself is messy. Life is messy. And here's what I mean. Mess is disorder. Mess is disruption to the way that things are supposed to be. Mess is whenever I thought one thing had a plan and that plan is now messed up. So it's a mess. It wasn't a plan in the directions of the cookies to break every egg on the floor. That wasn't the plan, so therefore it's a mess. And that's the thing about life. Things don't always just work out the way that they're supposed to. Things aren't always up and over, right? And that's how we would love for life to be every day, every season, is just another up and over trajectory of our life getting better and better and better and better. But it's just not that way. Life is messy, and I think life is way more discouraging and frustrating when we try to deny the fact that life's not going to go our way every time. It's not always going to go to plan, and your life isn't always going to look pretty, right? Some days you're going to go to work and you had your baby on your hip that morning getting them ready and you don't realize you got throw up and spit up all over the back of your shirt or something. Like some days are just messy. Some days things don't work out the way that we think they should. And here's the thing, though. I don't think it's supposed to look that way. I don't think it's supposed to always just look pretty and perfect. And I think we have to have a reality. It's not, will my life have a mess, but we got to figure out, what am I going to do with the mess of my life? Because you're going to have a mess at some point. She didn't plan to step in the pile of it. But the plan has got to be, what do I do with mess when it comes? And I want to look at this story over the next few weeks. It's a story called The Sermon on the Plain. And now it's a reflection of the Sermon on the Mount that we see in Matthew chapter 5 and 6. But some people think that it's the exact same sermon, just told through the lens of Luke. Some people say it's a different sermon, similar. Regardless, these are great to be read together. So if you want to kind of study throughout the weeks, you can read the Sermon on the Mount. Sermon on the Plain is found in Luke chapter 6. So what's happened is Jesus has been up all night praying, right? 5 minutes in, I run out of things to say. Anybody with me? You're like, and I started just saying Jesus, Jesus, Jesus over and over and over again. But all night he's praying. And then so he has just spent time, and all the 12 disciples are gathered. He spent time gathering Matthew and James and John and Peter and all these disciples. All the disciples have now, it's the beginning of his ministry, he's beginning to set out and do ministry, and this story happens. It says, he went down with them. He'd been up on the mountain praying all night. He went down with them, the disciples, and he stood on a level place. A large crowd of disciples was there, and a great number of people from all over Judea and Jerusalem and the coastal regions of Tyre and Sidon. So he's surrounded by all different kinds of people from all different kinds of places. He's got Judea and Jerusalem are Jewish culture cities that are overtaken by Rome, but there's a Jewish people that have come in. And we've got Tyre and Sidon, which is, this is all on the coast of the Mediterranean Sea. It's all a very, very close place, but people have all come from about 20 different miles around to see and to hear Jesus, because the stories are going around. This dude is healing people. This dude is seeing some miraculous things around him, and they want to come and see. Tyre and Sidon is it's an ancient city that yesterday I was watching it on the History Channel about like ancient boats, and Tyre was in this documentary. It's an ancient city made known for making the color purple, and it was very expensive, and these are not Jewish people. It's an ancient Phoenician city, and these are people who've served pagan and false gods. And so as he's looking out in the crowd, there's rich people, there's poor people, there's Jewish people, there's all kinds of people around him. And they came to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. Those troubled by impure spirits were cured. And the people all tried to touch him because the power was coming from him and healing them all. Imagine this moment. Power was coming out of Jesus and all of them were getting healed. This is pretty awesome. And he takes this moment as he's surrounded by a large crowd of all different kinds of people. He turns to his disciples and he's using the crowd as an object lesson to teach his disciples something. He turns to, it said, he looked at his disciples, he said, blessed are you who are perfect and proper and everything in order. Right? Mary Poppins, and perfect and proper and no. Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, you'll be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, you'll laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, whenever they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in the day and leap for joy. Hey, that doesn't seem right. For this is how they treated the ancestors treated the prophets. But woe to you, be careful. You who are rich, you've already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, you will mourn and weep. And woe to you when everyone speaks well of you, for That is how their ancestors treated the false prophets. Now, I want you just to get a little glimpse of what Jesus was saying. This is not the normal paradigm of how we want to live everyday life. He says, now, we also need to understand that Jesus doesn't say words just to say words. He's very articulate, he's very knowledgeable, and he says what he means to say. It's not just a cute, beautiful story. He's teaching something very powerful. And he says, the poor, the hungry, the sad, and the hated, those are blessed. The rich, the full, the ones who are laughing and liked, be really careful. Woe to you. Now, that sounds pretty opposite from the strivings of my everyday. This word blessed, it's the Greek word merikos. And merikos means like happy, but in this context, as it's read through in the Greek, really means more like fortunate. Think about that. He's like, how fortunate are you when you're poor? He looks out and he sees the ones who are sick and he says, those are the fortunate ones. That's not how I describe fortune, misfortune. And he says, whoa, which means unhappy. It's the antithesis. It's the opposite of, it's unfortunate. It's really a statement of pain and discomfort that Jesus is saying to these people. He said, woe to you who it seems like everything's going right. Now, I want you to understand this isn't a prescription for the condition. He's not saying, go out and seek to be poor. He's not saying, try to be sick. He's not saying, be hungry and I'm more pleased with you. But there's a bigger statement. It's the kind of a statement of being. It's the condition in which these people are. There's something deeper that God sees in them that's blessed. It's a Jesus paradox. As you read through the New Testament, you see a lot of these Jesus paradoxes, things that flip the script on how we think they should go, but Jesus says something completely opposite. See, what we have in life, we have these. I cleaned out my truck this morning, sorry about that. We have these buckets in life. We'll go green for go and red for stop. I think we can all understand that. We have these buckets and we categorize things on the daily based on how it made me feel, how comfortable it was, what was the plan, did it fit into the plan, and it goes into a bucket. This is the bucket of this is right, and it's successful, and it's a good bucket. This is the bad, don't go there bucket, right? And so we know, oh, this is trash, this goes in the bad bucket. This is a picture of my kid. I mean, that's got to go in the good bucket. She'll probably hate that picture. It's an old picture. We got bad. We got good because that's coffee and that's really good. And so we see life so black and white, don't we? If it's a good day and things went as planned, that's the good bucket. Everything was great. If it was bad and things messed up, I had a flat tire, somebody was rude to me, my schedule got off, the kids were rude, that's the bad bucket. And we categorize things, and the bad bucket means that must be a mess up. That must be a mistake. It must be something to be done away with and getting past as quick as possible. The green bucket, these are the things that my life needs. And we have a very linear, black and white view of what life is supposed to be like every day. But Jesus is saying something kind of a little weird. It's almost like Jesus is saying the things that we've been striving for to avoid and the things that we've been avoiding, strive for. It's this paradox, and I think it points to a deeper truth. I'm going to go just like a couple of things that I want you to understand how God sees the mess and the misfortune that we see as misfortune. Things that come that we wouldn't want, the difficulty. The first thing is that God sees them differently than we do. God doesn't have the same buckets, I don't think we do. God doesn't have the same goalposts and wins that we do. We have clear wins. If life went this way, it's a win. If life went this way, it's a loss, and I'll do better tomorrow. I don't think God has the same buckets. And you can read that from the story, because the people he says are blessed and fortunate do not look like the life that I'm trying to lead. His buckets, his goalposts, the winds of God are different. See, we see a mess. Actually, these are cough drops. I might need these. Put those up here. We see a mess in front of us. How could this happen? I'm miserable. Things didn't go the way that I planned. But my family's not treating me right. The job's not going right. Everything is a bust. When will all this just be over so that I can get back to the plan and getting my life back to where it's supposed to be? And God sees so often, I think, our mess as we're fortunate to be in it. Isn't that weird? Because he says, hey, you who are sick and poor and hungry, you're fortunate. Man, you're so fortunate. And misfortunate. It's very unfortunate when you're rich and things are perfect. That doesn't fit our paradigm. So it makes me think God has to see it differently than I do. That his buckets aren't as clear as black and white, good and bad. That maybe the mess, there's something bigger to it, and God sees it differently. What we see as a misfortune, God can look at and say, you're fortunate to be in that. See, we categorize everything in life, the quality of our life, the success of my life, how my day went, how I'm going to treat people, all based a lot of times off of what happened. My day was good, my day was bad. Because my life is defined by happy and easy and comfortable and things going my way, right? I mean, that's how we typically define a successful day. Everything was happy and easy and went my way and went in order. Very rarely do I have a day where things go perfectly in order. Most of the time, things are in complete disarray. Could the day of disarray be actually the day that God wants to use? And the day of order be one that God says, whoa, be careful. See, because our goalposts are typically happy and comfort, but God's goalpost for our life is not happy. Did you know that? The ultimate goal for your life from God is not happy. I believe God does want us happy, but happy is a byproduct, not a goal. God doesn't say, I want you to be happy as I am happy. What does he say? I want you to be holy as I am holy. Holy is to be without fault and to be pure and to be blameless before God's sight. That's God's ultimate goal. That's 1 Peter 1:16. Be holy. And holiness only comes through refining. The only way you get pure gold, which would be holy, is to set it on fire and scrape off the bad stuff. That doesn't sound fun if you're a piece of gold. The only way to get the pottery to be perfect is for it to be molded and shaped and punched and hit. And that doesn't sound fun if you're the piece of clay. He said, I want you to be holy, holy. See, we can be in the midst of a messy moment. Life's not easy, and sometimes we look up, and you're in the middle of something right now, and probably more questions than you have answers. And we ask why, and we get upset, and a lot of times that leads us to doubt and to quit. But maybe, just maybe, God sees it differently than you do, and that's not the end. That's actually part of what he's wanting to use. God sees the mess differently than you do. Maybe the mess isn't just a mess up. If God sees it differently than you, the big question is, whenever we're in the middle of it and we're frustrated and upset, the big question is, who's right, me or God? Now, I like being right. That doesn't mean I'm right. So there was these two couples. They went on a hiking trip. And there were the two guys and the two ladies. The two guys, they really were convinced. They knew exactly what they were doing and where they were going. They had the whole thing mapped out. and they kind of get off course for a few minutes. The guys are super confident. Hey, we got this. We know where we're going. They get up to this place where there's a violent river, and where they need to go is right on the other side of this violent river. And they're thinking, what in the world am I going to do? How are we going to traverse? So the guys, they get into action. They say, okay, I want you to go chop down that tree. I want you to get that string. And the women are like, hey, just right. Don't talk right now. I need you to go help and get this, and let's build this contraption. Hey, but what if we, no, I don't need you. Hey, I just need you to help me right now, right? Can you just help me and build? So they're building this device to traverse over. And so the men, they're in the middle of the river with this device through ropes and branches they've built to traverse this river, almost dying, tempting fate. And the women take a pause, they step back, and they pull out of the bag this thing called a map. They turn to the left, and about 100 yards, they see this thicket. It's briars and it's brush, and they get scratched up a little bit, but they're making their way through the thicket. But after just a few feet of the thicket, they see a beautifully man-made crafted bridge all the way across the river. They take the bridge across, they walk over, they wave at their husbands, they sit down and have a picnic. They saw things differently. Don't you know that God has the ability as well? We see things in it. God sees things from top down. We can't see what he's doing, but God sees it differently. What if the mess is actually a part of God's process? Often God's method is the mess. Have you ever been in the middle of a project at home? And that there's some moments in the middle of the project where everything looks way worse, right? If you're like me, sometimes at the end of the project, it looked worse. But I was having to fix some floor in our house, and there's for a few days, it looks bad. Like, I'm supposed to be repairing the house, and it's just in complete disarray. There's boards over here and nails there. Don't step there. It's bad. Anybody in the middle of the project, sometimes it looks a whole lot worse. Progress can look messy for a while. And if you skip the mess, you may just skip the process. I love this in Proverbs 14:4. I love this scripture. It says, where no oxen are, the manger is clean. But much revenue comes by the strength of the ox. What does that mean? It means if you want revenue and you want to be productive, you're going to have to deal with some poo. The manger may be clean when there's no ox, but there's also nothing happening in your life. If you want something to happen in your life and you want to move forward, sometimes it's going to be messy, and sometimes you're going to step in some poo. And think what God would say, if you try to just avoid the mess, you avoid the method by which I'm trying to do something incredible in your life. But what we do is we always just sink into despair whenever things don't go our way. And we stay in something longer than I think we need to be when we don't realize that the mess is part of the method. God hasn't forgotten you. He's trying to get you through. If we avoid or run from all the messes, we miss the work that he's trying to do. Will the mess define me, or will it refine me and make me more like God? Will I be known by this mess and just settle in it and live in it? Or will I allow it to make me better, make me more like God? God's work, God's best work, is in our biggest lack. What is rich, full, happy, and loved have in common? They already had everything they needed. That's what Jesus said. He said, woe to you because you have all that you need already. Jesus is basically saying, there's nothing I have to give you. You already have everything. But poor, sad, hungry, and hated, what's in common? They all have something that they lack. They all have something they don't have. It's a condition of lacking something. There's room that God can use. I would say in moments in your life, when everything's going perfect, when there is no stress, when there is no difficulty, when there's no diversion from comfortable, those are actually the moments to watch out for. Those are the moments that I think our lives are drifting and we don't even notice it. It's in the moments of the mess that I really think we're fortunate. And I know it seems crazy. It doesn't mean that we look forward to the mess. It just means that maybe the mess isn't a mess up and a mistake. Maybe it's part of the method that God wants to use, because he doesn't say, blessed are the poor, the sad, the hungry, by mistake. He said, I can do something with that lack. I can do something whenever you come to me with something missing, something that you can't do on your own. See, there's beauty in lack. There's beauty in not enough. Now, if you've ever looked in the fridge before and you didn't have enough, that doesn't feel beautiful in the moment, does it? When, like, what am I going to feed the babies? It doesn't feel very beautiful. When I don't know where I'm going to work, whenever I don't know what the diagnosis is going to be, it doesn't feel very beautiful. But God can do more with the lack than we can do with the full. God can do more with what we don't have than what we can do with what we do have. And he says, woe to you who already have everything that you need. Because it's so easy to, at that point, program God out. And we see him as an option and not a necessity. And God can do way more whenever we come to him with our lack. What if we've mislabeled our messes as mess ups, and God said it's actually an opportunity for his power to work in and through me? And what we do is we miss the opportunity because we mistake and mislabel the mess as a mess up. I'm looking at this and thinking, "There's God, when can I just get past all this mess?" And he said, that's not the point of the mess. You're fortunate. Would you just see that you're fortunate to be in it, even if you don't understand Paul in the New Testament? I've read this scripture so many times, but it illustrates this point so beautifully. I think that this guy, he was powerful, man. The Spirit of God was on him. He was planting churches everywhere it seems that he went. He was just an incredible man of God. He was healing people through the power of God. But then something happened in his own life that he called a thorn in his side. We don't really know what it is. He doesn't tell us, but all I know is it's not fun. It's not comfortable. I don't describe something as a thorn in my side when I enjoy it. If I tell you you're a thorn in my side, don't be like, yay, he loves me. No, it's a bad thing. It's a bad thing. Paul had some kind of thorn in his side. He had something going on in his life. And then we pick up in 2 Corinthians 12, 8 through 9, he says, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times to take it away from me. This guy who would pray for people on the street and they would walk up. They would stand up and walk when they haven't walked before. He's praying for his own ailment and God doesn't move. Wouldn't you doubt a little bit? This is the same guy who's ministering in prison, the same guy who's singing in jail, the same guy who you can't put a jailer strapped to him because he's going to evangelize the guy and he's going to get saved and help him escape. He must have saw something different. He said, I pleaded with God 3 times, take it away from me, but God said this to me. Nah, son, I ain't taking it away. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, Paul, going back to Paul, he said, I will boast. Like, I'm proud of my ailment. I will brag about that thing that's painful. Why? Because it's my weakness that makes God's strength come through me. I will boast all the more glad at my weakness so that Christ's power may rest on me, because my weakness is the gateway to God's power. My lack is the gateway to God's supernatural working in my life. If I come to God and I got everything together, you know what? You don't have much God can work with. I wonder if we've mislabeled the mess for a mistake when he said it's actually an opportunity for him to work in your life. Let your current situation remind you of God's perfect, incredible magnificent grace. God hasn't forgot you in what you're in. So we've seen maybe God's view of the mess and how he sees it differently. It's not all just a mistake, but what do we do with it? Because we've come to the conclusion we're all going to have a messy life. Hey, your life is not going to go to plan. Something is going to happen, and there's going to be some mess you're going to have to walk through. What do we do? How do we deal with the mess? How do we deal with the mess? Here's the first thing I would say. You got to invite God into the mess. You have to invite God in. See, without God, a mess is just messy. A mess is just misfortune. A mess is just misery. But I truly believe it. I know it's a little bit cliche. We saw it on all the church signs. But with God, a mess truly is your greatest message. It's your greatest victory. Poor and hurting and hungry and hated. Hey, it's far better with Christ than rich and full and happy and loved without him. But here's the deal. God has to be invited in, and we're not too good at that. Whenever things get difficult, we default to doing things myself, figuring it out myself, struggling alone. And God, I can do this. And our prayer normally is this. Here's our prayer. And you've probably done this prayer. You've heard this prayer. God, would you please get me out of this? God, would you deliver me from this mess? God, would you just get me past this season so I can get back to doing what you've called me to do? But can I let you in on a secret what a much better prayer is? Not God, bring me out, but God, would you meet me in? Come on, there's much more power in saying, God, meet me in my mess, than just get me out of my mess. There's an Old Testament story about three Hebrew boys that they were told, you've got to bow down and worship this idol. And they knew in their heart, man, I can't do that. But if they didn't bow down and worship this idol, they would be thrown into a fiery furnace. They would be killed immediately. But they decided that they were going to stand their ground, and they told them, they said, hey, whether God delivers us from it or he's with us in it, we will not bow down. And we would love to live the story where God miraculously swoops down and rescues them out, and they're like floating on the backs of butterflies, waving everyone goodbye. But that didn't happen. You know what? The door of the furnace opens, and they get thrown in. We know the rest of the story. They were saved. They didn't know the rest of the story. Can you imagine the moment from the front of the furnace to when they're getting thrown in, what they must be thinking? God, you've abandoned me. God, how dare you? I stood my ground for you, and now I'm in the middle of this mess. God, do you even care about me? Does that sound like any of our prayers? God, deliver me out of this. But you know what their prayer was? Even if you don't, God, meet me in this. And you know what he did? He met them in and walked with them through. Isaiah chapter 43, 2 says this. When you pass through waters, I will be with you. When you pass through rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be consumed. The flames will not set you ablaze. He didn't say, you're not going to go through water. You're not going to sometimes feel like you're drowning under the river and the weight of life. You're not going to go through the fire. No, he said, when you go through it all, when you have that rough day, when you have that thing that didn't work out as planned, when you have that diagnosis, whenever it seems like everything's in disarray and it's just a mess up, I will be with you. Now, I'll just deliver you. I believe for deliverance, too. I believe that God gets out of things, but I believe much more often God will be with us through things. And that's where our faith is developed, and that's how God makes us strong for the next thing that we're going to go through. It's through the thing that we're in right now. God can do more with your junk than you could do with a heap of treasure. But most of us never get to the level of faith to say, God, be with me in my mess, instead of just delivering me from it. The world's in a mess right now. God be with us in the middle of this mess. The second thing that I want us to do when we find our lives in just the middle of mess, it's the perfect time to define our motive. What do I mean? What do I really value in life? What's really important? What's my motive? What makes me get up? What makes me move in life? Because what happens is when life gets messy, my real values are revealed. Whenever life gets off kilter, it begins to reveal what's really most important to us. It's easy to cover that up and to pretend when things are perfect, right? But whenever everything is on its head, we cling to what matters, right? When I was a kid, we had a car, and Dad had to, I'm trying to remember through stories, I semi-remember the panic of the moment, but we were at my Aunt Rita's house, and she's here somewhere, and we pulled in, and we were going to leave, and my dad had to have this switch to, like, turn the fuel pump on, because, like, it was not a very nice car, barely running kind of car, so he would crank it and turn the fuel pump on. Well, something happened and a spark, and the fuel just kept pumping, and the car sets ablaze. And we are all in, we can't open the doors, and the car is on fire, and we're panicked and trying to get out and barreling out of this car. And in the front yard of my aunt's house, this car goes up in flames and just, like, burns to nothing. In that moment, I don't remember Dad going back in and saying, "Let me get that receipt." Right? It's like, "Oh man, that chewing gum out of the console." Thank God they didn't say, "Hey, you stay there for a minute, but let me get my wallet." No. See, because the crisis revealed what was important. In that moment, the only thing that mattered was getting that family out of the car. And so what happens in life, whenever life gets difficult and the messes, we're muddling through the mess, trying to figure out life, it reveals what I value. And so we have to ask ourselves, what is it that really matters in my life? A.W. Tozer said this, "Only after an ordeal of painful self-probing are we likely to discover what we actually believe about God." That's powerful. It's only in the pain can we actually come to a conclusion of what we truly believe about God. People, a lot of times whenever they get engaged and they want to get married, I tell people a lot of times, don't you dare get married until you get into an argument. It's like, don't tie the knot until something difficult happens and you got to traverse, because you don't really know who people are until things don't go as planned. Charles Colson said this, "Life isn't like a book. Life isn't logical or sensible or orderly. Black and white, things are here, things are there. This is good, this is bad." It's not the way God sees things. He says, "Life is a mess most of the time. And theology must be lived out in the middle of that mess." This is where life is actually lived. And nothing makes us examine our values and our motives like catastrophe and mess. It forces us to face our belief system. It forces us to ask the question, if I see a lack in my life, where do I go with the lack that I have? And that's why he looked out at this crowd and he said, "Blessed are them." It's not because they were poor. It's like, you should just all go, like, sell all your stuff and be poor. No, because he recognized these people had a lack, but they knew where to go with the lack. Where do I go with my lack? Where do I go? And so often whenever things get off kilter and mess happens in life, the last place that we run to is God. Yeah, he's the only one who can actually feel the lack. Is God really almighty? Is God really all-loving? Is God really able? Is God really mighty? And ask some personal questions. Does God really love me? Does God really have my best interest at mind? Why would I be going through this? Anybody ever ask these questions? It's the perfect moment to ask some questions that may be hard to answer. God, are you really holy? God, are you really mighty? John 14:8, one of his disciples, Philip, looked at him and said, Lord, show us the Father and that'll be enough. It's enough. He came to the conclusion that if everything else is lost, that God, you're enough. Psalm 16:5 says, Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. Jesus is more than enough. In the middle of the mess, we can look up and realize that sometimes I've been holding on and grasping for everything but God. Now, on the outside, I'll say it's God because it's a good Christian thing to do, and I have a Christian t-shirt and bumper sticker. But in reality, in my quiet place, the last thing that I've actually done is depend on and lean into God. So it's no wonder we have anything but hope and anything but peace. It reveals what you value. I would ask you to ask those questions today. God, do I truly value you above all else? And when you begin to value God above everything else, you'll see everything else differently. Maybe it's not just black and white. Maybe this that looks like a mess isn't bad. Maybe this that looks like it's just trash in my life, God said, that's good. I'll use that. Maybe this that I thought was perfect and planned, God said, no, that's that bucket. That wasn't my plan for you. Maybe this, you got this bill in, I don't understand how I'm going to pay for it. God said, you know what? That's good. You're depending on me. Maybe the messes have been mislabeled, and they're not as easy to define as we think they are. Because blessed and fortunate are those who are poor, hungry, unloved. God must see things differently. And the last one is, I would just encourage you in this. Don't avoid the mess. Adjust your focus. Don't avoid the mess. Adjust your focus. When there's a mess, what do you see? The mess. Right? Now, what I've been good at is sometimes I've kept the mess so long I might be able to overlook it. Anybody done that? It's like, that mess has been in the corner for 2 years. I don't even see that baby no more. The other day, you know, our kids wanted to make some cookies. Again, very thoughtful, very messy. They wanted to make some cookies, and so we come in, and there's some cookies made. And so excited because my youngest daughter has found an old recipe book from her deceased now nanny, and so she's going through these recipe books. She's wanting to make some of these recipes, and it's very sweet. So we walk in, and there's some cookies, but you know what I see? Sink full of dishes. And mess on the counter. And so my initial reaction is not, thank you so much for making me cookies. It's like, make sure you clean up your mess. Anybody with me? Pick up after, if you're going to be in here in the kitchen and you're going to clean, you make sure that you pick up after yourself. I forgot there was a dish full of cookies that she made for me and Christy. How often do we do that in life? God, just get me past the mess, but we don't see that there's something better in the middle of it. Because in the middle of the mess, all we see is the mess. But God said, I've got a message for you so much greater. This is probably the method I'm going to use. So instead of saying, God, just get me out. God, get me out. What if you say, God, would you join me in and adjust my focus? Adjust my focus, God, to not just see how everything is going wrong. Because it's crazy how sometimes we can get everything that we want and we're miserable in the things we got. God gave me everything. God gave me the job. He gave me the kids, and now I'm miserable every step of the way. So maybe I've got to adjust my focus from the mess to the God in it. God's doing something greater than you could imagine because he sees it differently than you see it. Help me to not just go through this, but God, help me to grow through this. God, don't just change my circumstances. Here's a good one. God, change me. It's really cute to preach that from the platform. It's something else when you don't have more than a dollar in the bank account and you have a flat tire on the side of the road. This is practical Christianity. It's theology lived out in the mess. But it's only in those moments you begin to see the message of God revealed through your life, and you'll begin to see the mess is beautiful. Do you realize that some of the most pinnacle, life-changing moments of my life, some of the things that I look back on and cherish the most, were birthed out of the biggest messes? Whenever I was in high school, my youth pastor, I've said this before, my youth pastor was killed by a drunk driver on the way home from a band practice at church. I never want to live through a pain like that again. But I know it's through the method of that mess that God brought me to being able to stand on a platform because of my role model who made a difference in my life. The pinnacle moments, the messes are not fun, but they can be beautiful. Because God said, whenever I'm invited in and they're in my hands, I can do way more of the mess than you could do with the treasure. The problem is, we don't let him in very often, do we? What if we quit spending so much time trying to avoid the mess, and we spent more time focusing on him and inviting him into it? It's only in mess do you understand grace. It's only in lack that we comprehend fullness. That's why I think he was like, blessed are you who are poor, because when you come to me, you get to comprehend rich. Blessed are you who are sad, because you know what it's like when you live in joy. Blessed are you, fortunate. You're so fortunate when you're hungry right now and you don't know where you're going to go for your next meal, because the fullness of God inside of you, you'll know what it is. Blessed are you whenever people don't like you, because you'll know what it's like to truly be loved by the Father. Like, we're fortunate. And God, forgive me for missing opportunities to see you in the middle of the mess. And just wanted to avoid where I'm at and not invite you in to get me to what's next. God, would you just be in the middle of the mess with us? I invite you in, God. Would you stand up with me? Instead of living in the misery of trying to look past, I encourage you to look up and look in. And here's a question that maybe you need to write down, maybe you can remember it. And I think it's going to take a little bit more in introspection than I'm going to give it time for. But I want this question to really sink into you. God, what do you want to do in me through this? And God, what do you want to do through me in this? God, what do you want to do in me, inside of me as I'm going through this? And God, what will you do through me in this? God, we're so grateful that life, it's messy. It's so messy. It's so difficult. But God, maybe the perfect up and over, everything going the way that it's supposed to, life is not what you've call us to. Maybe that's not actually the path. Maybe the beauty is in the mess. It's only when the ox is in the stable. Sometimes we've got some stuff to deal with in life. So God, right now we're in all varied places in this room. Just like the crowd that was surrounding Jesus, there's people from all different walks of life, people who know you, people who have no clue maybe who you are, God, people who have a lot, people who have a lot of lack. God, I pray that you just look at each one of our hearts and that we would all look at you as we're sitting in the middle of our mess and we would bring it to you. Father, I lift you up. Forgive us, God, for trying to deal with our mess alone, for trying to avoid the mess. God, and thank you that we're so fortunate to see your grace at work in the middle of mess. As your eyes are closed, real quick before we leave, if you're in this place and you say, hey, Pastor, you did a lot of talk about Jesus and things like that, but I don't know Christ. The reality is I don't know where I would go if I were to die today, heaven or hell. There's only two options. The Bible paints that picture, makes it very clear. But you want to make sure that your eternal home is in heaven. Jesus did everything that it took. He died on the cross to pay for every sin and every shame that you could ever carry and everything that you've ever done so that you could be in the family of God and have your home in heaven. All we do is receive it. And if that's you today and you're like, I need Jesus in my life, would you slip your hand up? Come on, thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Here's the second one. Your life's messy. And honestly, right now, it just hurts a little bit. Maybe it hurts a whole lot. And show me to agree with you in this moment. God, meet me in the middle of my mess and give me a message that's so much greater than I can imagine. If that's you, just slip your hand up. Father, God, we all humbly come before you, God, and admit our messes, and God, meet us in it. You've seen the hands that went up. God, thank you. Thank you for the mess because you're doing something so great through it. Marikos, we're fortunate. Fortunate. You didn't say that by accident. It's something you can use. So God, would you use it? God, I pray for the hands that went up to receive you as their Lord and Savior. God, if we just simply say, God, forgive me of my sin. I give my life to you. In that moment, all is made new and made right, and we're found in your family, God. So I just pray that as they pray that prayer, everything would change. And as they leave today and things may not feel any different, God, let them know that they are completely changed from the inside out. I love you, Lord. I thank you for all that you're doing. Thank you for all that you're working in every life in this place and people watching online. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, can we just give it up to God?